everybody, this is Aya. Thank you for tuning into my channel, Wild Free and Tangled Fairy. I have tried to make this video so many times because I keep running into my own emotional distress. And I finally got a chance to cry out. I'm like, what is my problem? Why am I having such a hard time with this? And it was because I was feeling afraid. I was reliving a lot of the fear. That was stuck inside of my body for a really long time. So within the Cinderella effect of Mars in the 12th house, this is Monke. I decided to make him a part of the video. This is a self-object for me. I've had him ever since I was 6, 7. And I lay with him, cuddle with him whenever I feel afraid. He brings me lots of comfort. His name's Monke, so say hello, everybody. I need to patch up his arm. This is a new development. I patched up his mouth not too long ago. But whatever. My baby. But, right. So in talking about the Cinderella effect of Mars in the 12th house, I felt like it was important for me to talk about the early stages of development, all going back pre-birth to gestation and what your mother may have been experiencing, because Mars is a representation of drama, rage, violence, right? Those are the negative connotations. And so the higher aspirations of Mars would be spirituality, creativity, healthy sexual connection, healthy boundaries, and or communication of boundaries. Because rage and anger is about, my boundaries are broken, don't come any further. If you come any further, we're going to fight. That's Mars. Mars first is, you're supposed to assert yourself. Mars is where you have a natural assertiveness. With Mars in the 12th house, or Mars with Neptune, or Neptune in Aries, or your ascendant, which is ruled by Mars, connected to your 12th house, those lines get blurred and things become really hazy as to do I belong to myself? Am I able to exist on my own accord? Am I here to just be everybody's slave? Am I here to just exist for what other people expect my personality to be, expect me to do with my time, my life? Am I allowed to receive, or do I always have to give? You know. With Mars in the 12th house, Neptune or the 12th house or Pisces energy has to do with past lives, and early childhood development. And so your development was plagued with Mars energy. Mars energy meaning that either your family line was probably both. So your family line, super talented, spiritually inclined. You're probably part of the fire tribe, and maybe even sun gods and goddesses. Very fire, solar energy, ancient energy, wisdom, talented at astrology, talented at using your psychic abilities to help people heal, talented at being a medium, talented in your ancestry line is magic, right? And also creative geniuses. So the reason why you were born with Neptune in the 12th house, or Mars in the 12th house, is to end something. Anytime there's a planet or energies in the 12th house, you're here to break a cycle of some sort. It ends with you. The buck stops here. So what is it that you're here to end? So, although your family has ancient roots, a lot of wisdom, there was an abuse of power, of violence, this immature ways of handling energies that need to be forgiving, blaming, shaming, pointing the finger, jealousy, not allowing people to develop who they are. The violence has gotten out of control. The unaccepting of who people are and their personality out of control. The love, the intimacy is based upon more upon performance than upon just your love because you exist. It's a thing where you're not liked and loved for just because of who you are. You're only liked and loved if you are a slave. If you are do what you're told and allow people to dictate who you are. So then are you really loved? No. Are you really known? No. Are you really certain of your existence and what you're supposed to do this lifetime at all? How could you be if you don't get a chance to express, because Mars is about expression, right? You don't get a chance, if anytime you express your true personality, it's a hope, it's a light, it's an attitude, it's a eye roll, it's a criticism, it's a naysayer, it's a yeah, right. It's just the environment is full of shade. No room to sprout up. So you're constantly going back down. Every time you try to sprout up, you get put back down. Every time you try to sprout up, you get put back down. Sprout up, down, sprout up, down, until you give up. Give up. You don't ever give up. Mars in the 12th house never gives up. And that's what makes this aspect really exciting to me. Although it's one of the most challenging initiation processes to have in an astrology chart, which is why so many people are studying it, trying to find information, help me out of this hell, the hell of the sensations of my body. Now, the reason why you're having a hard time getting through it, because like I said before, it starts before birth. So there's really no words. It's kind of like when I started talking about this, all I could do when I first got on camera is tell my story. And it was jamming me up. I'm like, I don't feel right. I don't know why I don't feel right. I don't feel comfortable in my skin on camera right now. I don't like how I'm feeling. And sometimes I push through that and I just put the video out anyway. And because I just trust spirit. But it was so uncomfortable. I was like, And then I went upstairs and I'm like, why do I feel so uncomfortable with this? Is it because I'm not supposed to do this? Please, spirit, make it clear to me. You know, and I just started being like, I am so scared, which is very Mars in the 12th house. Fear. A lot of fear. And not feeling safe, which is why your spiritual connection is sublime. I remember supernatural experiences before I could really speak. My spirit guides and guardian angels would appear to me, would literally carry me and make sure I was safe. Spiritual gifts are developed through trauma. This is a very traumatizing aspect. That if many people hear your story, they would just be like, oh my God, I am so sorry. Oh my God. Oh my God. It's just, the oh my God will re-traumatize you, you know, while you're trying to tell your story or express it or whatever. So I'll tell a little bit of mine since I got through the tears and I don't feel so awkward. The violence predate before I was born. My mother and my father were both abused by their mother and their father. In my mother's side of the family, my great-grandmother told me that her father would beat her. She said he would get Papa. She told me Papa would just get the beatings and the beatings and the beating and the beating and the beating. She just kept... I was like, oh my God. Gigi, I am so sorry, because that's what we call our great-grandma, Gigi. I am so sorry. She was like, I don't know why, but she ran away. But she got sent away. And she had my grandma when she was 13. And so that kind of violence kind of just passed down. And of course, it has to do with slavery. The slave masters, in order to keep the slave masters from beating their children, the slaves would beat their children. Be like, I'm going to beat you so you don't get it worse from the slave master. And so it was just something that just, the corporal type of punishment got passed on. And the rage also gets passed on as well. That's what happens when you beat your children. It stores up rage within them. I encourage anyone that's interested in kind of exploring this concept and what it does to the psychology of a human being and what it does to our society to read the book, The Drama of the Gifted Child. I think her name's Alice Miller, which is one of the first of many books that I read that opened my eyes to the fact that I'm not crazy for feeling how I feel and suffering the way I suffered in my childhood and seeing things the way I saw it. I'll say this. I won't say it. I'm late. So yes, both of them, and then on my dad's side, my pop, you can listen to, watch the video about my pop sacrificing his family on the altar for power, for spiritual power. And also my aunt said that he had MK Ultra because he was in some form of military, the Air Force or something. And my aunt said that he was experimented on. And then on top of that, I learned through contacting my ancestors through possession that he did some work, where he sacrificed his family. So that's another video. So he told me he went out of control. He lost control. It was too much for him, and he ended up doing awful things to his family. Okay? So then my parents copulate, create me, and my mom had me when she was 18. And she was kicked out of the house as soon as she graduated from high school. My grandma and my Gigi were disappointed that their daughter, that they raised better than this, was pregnant. She was pregnant with me. I'm not a disappointment. I'm a prize. I am not a mistake. And so she was kicked out, and for part of that time she was homeless. Because she refused to live by their rules. So they were like, you can come home if you live by our rules. And part of their rules, and maybe she had to go to college. She had a scholarship to go to college. They were in like this debutante society, like high society stuff thingy. And yeah, my father was a drug addict. My mother participated in withdrawal drugs too. She would never tell you that, but she did. And they used to go to blows and fight each other. And they were very violent towards each other. And I would wake up in the middle of the night grinding my teeth from the stress and being afraid. The first few years of my life was filled with violence and fear. And I know a lot of people with Mars in the 12th house can relate to that. Being born to parents that aren't prepared for you. Being born to parents that don't have much emotional intelligence and coping skills. For everyday living. Being born into a family that's highly talented, inspirational even, very strong, very passionate. And very violent and have
power off
psychological issues from their childhood. Okay, so the Cinderella effect started for me at 3, maybe earlier. I'm going to say 3 because that's when my little sister was born. That's also when my mother abandoned us to go to the army to run away from my father. So she promised she would come back for all of us. She lied to him just so she can get away. She wasn't planning on coming back. My father lost his mind because he didn't have any support. They didn't have any support. He would leave to look for a job or to get high. I don't know exactly all the details. And I would be at home all day and all night trying to take care of my little infant sister. I was changing diapers at 3 as best as I could. So that's where, for me, where I know, because I have asked, and I also have, these are from memory. Some things are from me researching and asking my aunts what they remember about my birth story. And I recommend that you guys find out your birth story, because it'll answer a lot of questions as to the stress and tension you hold in your body. My aunt told me that my father lost his mind and he started hearing voices saying to kill me and my sister. He put us in a tub and he had a machete and he called my aunt, and my aunt said, don't kill them, bring them to me. So he brought me and my sister to my aunt. And my aunt told me that when I first got to her house, I wasn't talking, I didn't play. I was basically frozen. And that was a sign and signal to me from my research that I was traumatized. I was traumatized. That's if you have children around you and they're not speaking and they're not playing and they're not able to move or be present, they're traumatized. And so eventually I thawed out and I was able to play. And for me, those are the memories in my childhood where I have a sensation in my body, an inner resource of me feeling like a kid and not having any responsibilities. But that's kind of where it ended. Because going back to when my mother got caught wind that I was with my aunt and her competitive nature, she came and got us from my aunt because my aunt did not like her. And I think that she really just wanted my dad to suffer because she wanted to be vengeful. But she didn't necessarily want anyone else to win. Petty boots. And so, back at the ranch with my narc mom, she basically put responsibilities on me. She's like a big sister that I never asked for or wanted or needed. And so, yeah. Cinderella effect, needs not getting met, not filled up with love, not filled up with affection, but showing love, affection, attention, and support to everyone around, the reciprocal nature, the ability to receive love and resources gets diminished in order to survive, and you become a happy slave. That's a defense mechanism. You become someone that doesn't ask for anything and is okay with very little. That's how you survive being in that type of environment. Some of you. Not everyone has the same experience. There are different variations. Now, for me, the father energy exited, and then the stepfather energy came in and changed the dynamics even more so for me into not allowing the expression of my boundaries. People who are carriers of the narcissistic archetype are habitual line crossers. And so my stepfather came in and saw that me and my mother argued a lot, like sisters. We fought a lot, because that was the only way to get through to her, to not be an asshole. Or, you know, just to stand up for myself as a person. We argue, and it was just a normal, everyday thing. It's like, Mom, I'm not wearing pigtails. Mom, I'm not wearing polka dots. Those are most of the time my battles. I don't want to eat Whoppers every day. I didn't argue about that. I did eat the Whoppers every day because my mother didn't cook. Until my stepfather came around. Then she pretended like she was fucking Betty Crocker. And I would be looking at her like, really? You're just gonna like magically become the perfect wife? He was tricked, okay? I was trying to tell him, you don't know. You do not know. Because he would be like, she's spoiled. You let her talk to you any other type of way. She needs to show respect. I started getting whoopings. In order to make him feel like a man, she let him come in and infiltrate and change the dynamics of everything. So he can feel like a leader, even though he didn't know what he was doing. You don't come in and you tell nobody else's children nothing. And expect all types of weird respect that you didn't earn. You didn't build a relationship with us. Boy, bye. You know? And so, that happened. My voice got smaller and smaller, which gives your body the signal that you're not respected and you're not worthy of respect. Mars is about respect. So you become, again, I say this again, a happy slave, taking on the responsibilities of your parents, not really being able to have a way out of it. It's part of the initiation. In past lives, you're kind of carrying the karma of your family, of for whatever debt that needs to be paid, and pay it in your body. And it's not, you're not the only one in the family. You're the sensitive one that is aware that this ain't right. You know, because you might have gotten the brunt of the abuse, other people got to live a little bit more freer around you, and they were just happy it wasn't them. And so no one necessarily stood up for what was right, because everybody's just trying to survive in a stressful environment. And then you also become the protector, which is Mars energy too, the warrior in the family, the town crier, the truth teller, which you get punished for. You also get punished for trying to individuate and show your gifts, show your talents. All the normal stuff of Mars energy, all the development, the hormonal development, you get in trouble for just naturally growing up and being true to yourself. Your psycho-spiritual self is not allowed in the environment. Very painful. And I'm saying this with words, and I don't take for granted how painful it is. I have spent the last 10 years healing these different layers and levels of my development, and I am not done. I'm not. And I've come to the realization that that's okay as well. I was looking at the beginning, I was always looking for the end. I was like, oh, I feel better. It's the end. I did. Yes. And then another layer would come, another wave of triggers and stuff would come to be, come up and rise up to be faced and healed. And then one day I read an article that was like, it'll take you at least 7 years to feel normal. And I needed to see that so that I can stop doing that to myself. Which makes sense. I mean, I spent almost 27 years brainwashed. I didn't even realize I was abused until later, for real. I knew that something was wrong and off, but I didn't know to the extent. And that's a different video about like what happened when I awakened and stuff like that. To the truth about my existence. So I very much felt responsible for my other siblings. I very much was the mother for everyone, including my mom. And everyone got attached to me being the mother. And then, just like any other narc, when she was done with me, I was still cast out. I thought that one day, I was hoping one day she would be fair and allow me, basically give me my freedom papers and let me be my own person at a certain age. I felt like I had served my, given her her time, given her her ruling over me that she asked for. And when I wanted to like play, be on a tennis team, I expected for her to be supportive and to be understanding. And she, I mean, she would give me little spurts of freedom here and there, but then she would be like, who's gonna watch the kids? And I would turn to her and be like, I guess that's me. And not just be pissed that she will allow me to do that. Like, she will allow me to consider, to always sacrifice what I wanted to do. Mars in the 12th house. Okay? When I was done and I got fed up with it, I was done, child. I haven't talked to her in 10 years. The day I was like, I'm done, I give up, is the day I was trying to work on. I'm like, I want reciprocity. I never really asked her to meet any of my needs, including in conversation. Just every conversation was about her and her boyfriends and her world and her life and her suffering. I would just always be a listening ear. And one day I started asking her questions and wanted to know why certain events happened in my life and why she treated me in certain ways. I started like awakening to the true nature of the relationship and my place that I was in the family, and I didn't want that anymore, and I wanted to be my true self, and I wanted people to really get to know me, and I wanted her to really get to know me and be interested in me as a human being. And girl, you would have thought I had thrown a brick through her window and cussed her slap out and took her man and shaved her bald and killed her cat and stole her bike and ate the last piece of gum and ate all the chips and left the little piece of orange juice at the bottom of the carton. Like, she was like, how could you do this to me? Okay. And so then she ended up cussing me out and telling me that if I did not like her, then I should just stop fucking talking to her and don't call her anymore. And I fell to the ground. And I was like, why doesn't my mom love me? Why doesn't she love me? That was it for me. That was it. I mean, besides her flying a coop and stalking me when she felt spiritually that I was individuating and becoming autonomous, that's really it. I haven't really seen her or talked to her since. Okay, that's hard. It's not easy for me to I can feel myself going into like a fake space to, because I don't want to show my emotions. But something's getting to me about this. I think what got to me was when I started talking about when she cussed me out. I didn't want to say that to you guys for some reason. I didn't want to express that she cussed me out and told me to never fucking talk to her again. Like, that still hasn't found its place inside of me completely. I was uncomfortable. But yeah, I broke out of the Cinderella role and I faced guilt and shame and isolation, abandonment. But I had always experienced that in my life. I had found defense mechanisms, which we'll talk about later, all types of defense mechanisms, to not feel that. And defense mechanisms are not evil. They just don't work in anywhere else except the environment in which they were developed or in relationships that remind you of the situation that you were born into. So, it's another deep video from me that I'm sure a lot of people can relate to, and we're definitely not finished talking about the Cinderella effect. And I feel like it's very much so Cinderella energy, to where someone is basically antagonizing you and wanting to fight you basically all the time, and you just continue to love and be sweet and be kind, not because you don't got that fire up in your bones, but for survival. What is a child supposed to do in that situation when they feel bullied and threatened consistently? Do what you're told. And basically what the energy is asking for you to do is to not exist and to become part of the darkness and to not know who you are and to not have the wherewithal and a goal and audacity to express your beauty, your heart, your kindness, because that being or whatever it is has lost hope and love, and they're crying out for love, and so they're jealous of anyone who possesses what they think they can't have or aren't. Jealousy, to me, correct me if I'm off the mark, I would love to hear anyone else's wisdom, but jealousy to me is an energy construct that's just unwilling to go through the healing process that they need to go through in order to believe in themselves. And so they have sidelined themselves to be on the outskirts of life, watching other people live as a commentator instead of like expressing themselves and being courageous and living. But anyway, okay. Whew. I think I want to put at the beginning of this video triggering. Beware of triggers. Wah, 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 wah. Triggering, triggering, triggering. Triggers are a blessing. And I'm actually making the outline of some type of system to help people really use their triggers to their advantage. All right. I'll talk to you guys soon. Peace.